Okay.
You are recording. Okay. So maybe we can start with the afternoon session. And it's a pleasure to have as chair of this session, Professor Adrian Luca.
Hello, everyone online and here. Mm-hmm. So let's start the session. Matteo, you. Okay, you share the slides. Matteo, the floor is yours. It seems that you have 25 minutes to talk and 5 minutes, please for questions.
Bye. Yes. Okay, thank you. And thank to the organizers for inviting me today to give this talk and to this conference. Okay, the subject in general, I could tentatively say the following. So I want to describe the behavior of laminates, which are breaking. Okay, so laminates are sort of very wide. And now I have actually in mind a very specific example, which I will show you. But the philosophy somehow is the following. So if you look at this picture here, you see this wing. And we want to understand what is the elastic response of the wing, and in general also the response taking into account the possibility to fracture. But then the material is not homogeneous, you see, it is made of several layers. So this layering is very interesting because it's a layer made of two different materials, and this is called a layup. And in the layup, basically you have the materials which are just rotating. So you have different layers, this blue and this, I don't know, gray, whatever. Sorry, I don't see well colors. And you see that these lines are indicating you that the materials are not homogeneous and they are just rotating, okay? Now, actually, I have to say a very specific example. Which is incredibly singular. So the example here was this problem actually was raised by Kaushik Bhattacharya a couple of years ago during a conference in fracture. And it presents an effect which is called toughening by elastic contrast. Okay, what is the meaning? So the point is the following. We have a material which is made of two different materials called A and B, let's say. And you have this laminate here. There's a crack here. So the material is loaded. This is the experimental configuration. So you see you are loading in this way, in a way that you open. And then, of course, you will see the fracture moving inside the material here. It will propagate here, say, vertically and here horizontally. And then you want to see, in some sense, the average behavior of the material. So instead of looking at the material as a sum of layers, you want something more general, sort of a average behavior. Now, what I found out experimentally and numerically is the following, which for me is still surprising today. So the two materials have the same Poisson ratio and they have different elastic modulus. This difference is what is called the elastic contrast. And toughness is the same. So toughness is the resistance to fracture of the two materials, okay? Now, what they found out is that basically, if you look at the system in a sort of average way that we will describe, you get an effective toughness, which is much higher than the toughness of the two materials, which are the two materials here, gray and red in the layer, okay? So I will come back to this slide, and I want first to explain you a little bit about what happens in the homogeneous material, and then we will switch to the non-homogeneous material. Okay, now the problem is the following. So if you have a homogeneous material and you are loading, for instance, in these two holes according to this standard test, then the problem is to find the position L of the crack tip as a function of time, okay? You load in time and you want to know if the crack is moving, where it is stopping, and how far it is going. Now, we will use a very simple criterion. It is very old. It is, in some sense, cultural heritage of this criterion, which is purely mechanical, and it is based on two ingredients. So the elastic energy and the dissipated energy. and actually the derivatives of these two quantities, okay? So let me be a little bit more precise. Now, in Griffith criterion for a brittle material, it is really the simplest possible choice that you can do. So the amount of energy which is dissipated simply depends on the elongation of the crack times a certain constant. Now, this constant is a constant which depends on the material. It is called toughness, okay? Is of course positive, and of course if you take the derivative you get this. Now, for elastic energy, I mean the following. So if you are given time and the length of the crack, then you can compute the equilibrium configuration, okay? You compute the equilibrium configuration and then you compute the elastic energy in the equilibrium configuration. So in this way, we get rid of one variable, the displacement, and we end up with a problem which depends only on time and length, as in the previous slide. Okay, so dependence in time is very simple. The dependence of the elastic energy with respect to the length of the crack is less simple, it is not explicit. So here I plotted just an example which came from my numerical simulation, which were actually very simple. And it shows, you know, that the amount of energy which is stored in the material as a function of the length of the crack with fixed boundary condition behaves in this way. So you see that it is decreasing with respect to the length of the crack. And this you can expect it because if you elongate the crack, the amount of elastic energy will decrease because the number of elastic bonds will decrease. And you see, at least qualitatively, but you can also prove it, that it is smooth and non-convex. Okay, so you take the derivative of this energy here, sorry, with respect to the length. The derivative will be negative because the function is decreasing. You change the sign in order to have a positive constant, and you define in this way the energy release. Now, these two quantities, toughness and energy release, basically they play during the evolution and they define the evolution according to Griffith criteria. Now, instead of explaining you in details, I just try to plot in some sense the evolution. Now, in this Cartesian plane, you have time in the horizontal axis and then length in the vertical axis. And you can draw this line here, which is dotted, which is the set where the energy release equal toughness. Now, this set is a set of critical equilibrium configurations. And indeed the C, which you see here, stands for critical. Now, when you draw this line, basically you split the Cartesian plate in two parts. On the left are stable configuration, on the right are non-equilibrium configuration, and along this line you have instead the critical equilibrium configuration. So this says the following: if you pick up one point in this plane, then you can say whether the crack will be stable or not, will move or not according to this position. And indeed, you know, you can very easily now plot the evolution as a function of time. You start from L naught, you load in time moving to the right, and you will see no evolution until this time here, which is the initial time for the evolution. Why? Because all these configurations are configuration in which the system is in equilibrium, so there won't be any motion. You get to this point, you cannot stay here because the equilibrium will be critical after this time, and then you move to the closest point in the equilibrium configuration. And you move in some sense instantaneously to this point. Then you go on along this line here, you go up, and then you end up splitting into pieces the domain, okay? So basically you see that there are different ways of evolving, either being, say, stationary, perfectly stationary constant, or jumping, or then sliding along this line. Now, the characterization that you can use from a mathematical point of view is given here, okay? This is not, say, what I really want to explain, but the point is that somehow you see that all the properties here of irreversibility, equilibrium, stability, and non-equilibrium are somehow the ingredient of the evolution, which here is unique because I have monotone loadings, okay? Now, there's one point which is very important about this type of evolution, and is the energy balance. So for this type of evolution, if you read the first line, you see some sort of classical energy balance. final elastic energy equal initial elastic energy plus work of external forces is the integral of power of external forces minus dissipated energy. Okay, this looks really like what you would expect always. But actually, since we have these discontinuous and very fast or catastrophic propagations in these discontinuity times where you have this motion which is instantaneous, basically it appears another type of dissipation which is concentrated only, you see, in this set. So when T, what is JL? JL is the set of jumps, is the set of points, of times, in which the evolution is, so basically it cannot be in equilibrium and it has to go instantaneously to a new equilibrium. This, of course, is a very simple representation of an extremely fast evolution, okay? Even if, okay, the relationship between fast evolution and this is always not so clear. Now, this dissipation here, this extra dissipation which happens there is a positive constant, is a positive quantity. Okay, now I want to explain you very briefly how you compute the critical value of toughness, okay, the GC. This is important because physically, I mean, one is used to have the constant and then see what you get as an evolution. But actually, you cannot have a direct measure of this dissipated energy. And you have an indirect way of measuring. And usually, you do it in this way. So you know, you measure as a function of time the position of the crack tip. Then once you know this, the energy release, which you compute by J integral, then you set G critical equal to G. Why? Well, if you go back, you think that the evolution is on this line. When the evolution is on this line, so this line is the level set G equal to G critical. So in this way, you define experimentally the constant there. Actually, if you do it, so basically you see the following, that somehow Griffith criterion enters into the definition of the constant. It seems to be a sort of a circle. Now, the first observation is the following. Not always you get really a constant. So in some cases, it is almost constant. But if you go here or even here, then you see that this value is not really constant. It depends a lot on the material. And typically, our composite, the material which have this curve instead of a constant, which is called the resistance curve. Okay. Now, let me go to the example that I want to describe a little bit more in detail. Now, this is again a composite, so we can expect something, say, strange. And let me now focus on this plot. We didn't see this plot in the previous slides. Now, in this plot, you see as a function of time, a couple of quantities. Now, this line here is representing the length of the crack, okay, as a function of time. While what you see here is the J integral, which equals the energy release as a function of time. So you see that here along this line, there is a big drop. And the big drop is due to the fact you are moving from one material to the other. One material is softer than the other in some sense because it's releasing more or less energy because the Young modulus is different. And according to this, you see that in correspondence to this drop, there's a discontinuity in the evolution. So what do we expect now? Let me, sorry, give you a little bit more of a detail. Now, here you maybe can hardly see, but the variation that you see, where the solution is somehow continuous, is this, is basically equal to the variation here along the vertical line, roughly, okay? This means the following, that these pieces of the evolution correspond to the pieces here of the material. So in some materials, the fracture will go very fast because the material is somehow less resistant. In other, it will move instead continuously in time. And now, this tells you the following, that in some sense, when you make a transition between one to the other, you have to expect a discontinuity. So there will be a lot of discontinuities in the evolution. Now, let me go to the mathematical description. Okay, this is slightly different from the assumptions that we have seen before, because the say the experimental setting is not really as this one. Okay, I'm sorry for that, but it's not easy to explain why they have chosen that and I'm choosing this. Okay, so basically now you have this material which is made of all these layers, material A and material B. Lambda here is the volume fraction of the two materials. And now here to simplify, I am considering just anti-plane displacement. So here the displacement is going, say, out of the blackboard and on the other side, inside the blackboard or whiteboard. And so basically you have something like this, okay? So the material opens in this way. And of course, the more you open, the more the crack will propagate. Now, what you basically do, now I don't want to give the details because we have seen in the homogeneous case, you have the elastic energy and you have the dissipated energy. So we have somehow to do the same with some differences, of course. Now, you have an elastic energy which depends now on this elasticity matrix here. And you have, of course, parameter depending on the material. So here, this is a little bit more general. So it can completely depend on the material. Now, you define the energy once again. You take the equilibrium configuration and you compute the energy. And then you take the derivative with respect to the length of the crack. And this gives you this quantity here, the energy release. Now you do the same for basically the dissipated energy. And of course, we have two different values here. Now, I will not enter into this, but of course, energy release and toughness are discontinuous when you switch from a material to another. Okay, this is of course, we cannot avoid it. Now, very well, basically what you do, you just redefine your evolution and you have the evolution that you expect, okay? I don't want to reread everything here. It is just the evolution in the sense of Greek criterion with this shortest connection to the equilibrium configuration. And of course, as I told you before, we expect now to see lot of discontinuities here, okay? Very small in length because this could be very small, but still we see a lot of them. So in some sense, when here we have this condition on the non-equilibrium configuration, which is what happens in the discontinuities, we have to take into account that there will be a lot of them, okay? They will be spread in all the domain. Now, the energy identity is exactly the same. Once again, since we may have many of these catastrophic evolution, we expect to have some dissipation, which is related to each of these points. Now, is the time, to go to the averaged setting, so to do this homogenization. So homogenization means really to have an average description of the system. And mathematically, this is done, let's say, taking the limit as n tend to infinity. So n is the number of layers. You want now to understand what is the behavior, you try to send n to infinity somehow. So you think you have many of them. Why? Well, basically, if you think that you have a material which is like, for instance, if you have masonry and you have a church or a tower, then it's much better to have a homogeneous description rather than describing the single elements. For instance, this is the same that you have here. This is nacre, it is madre perla in Italian, but you have all this layer at the scale, which is very small. You cannot think of resolving all of them. Okay, so we have to try to do the same procedure as in the previous cases also here. But now we have to take into account that the number of layers has to become very, very large. And so we want in the limit to understand what is going on. Now, some good news. The energy, elastic energy, will indeed converge to what is called the homogenized elastic energy. Now, how do we find this? So there's a very formula which is explicit from the late 70s, and which tells you the following. You start from a material with two different coefficients here, and now you end up homogenizing, so in average, with a material with two new coefficients, which are given by these two formula. So the second one, the second coefficient is just the average. The first is the harmonic mean of the two. But what is important here is the following, that you can get these two coefficients only depending on the coefficients of the original materials, 1 and 2, and the volume ratio. Okay, that's all. Now, we have more. We have convergence of displacement and stress at equilibrium, weak convergence. And also, we can take convergence of the dissipated energy. So now, if you have a very fine layer, behaves in average as if you have this quantity here, which is an average of the two toughness. And then we have also the following, the evolution are converging somewhere. Okay, these are the good news. It seems that at this point, you have just to put all these ingredients together and see, but actually it is not so. It is not so because what happens is that the evolution that you get in the limit does not satisfy Griffith criterion for the homogenized energy released and for the homogenized toughness. In general, this is due to the fact that these quantities are not converging. So we have convergence of energy, but we don't have convergence of derivatives of energy, or actually we have a weak convergence there. And second, it happens that the homogenized toughness is an average, and so it is always in between minimum and maximum. And this seems to be inconsistent with the experimental result that we have seen. Okay, so this also explains why in the experimental result we are talking about an effective toughness. It means the following. So this is somehow the way of making formal, or to give a proof of this, is that one can actually define a quantity which is called effective toughness in a way that Griffith criterion holds. In which way? You see, I am combining the energy release for the homogenized material, because for elasticity we have sort of a perfect matching with the homogenized material, and this effective material here, and this effective toughness, sorry. We have the energy identity, fine. So we can, in some sense, close the circle, but now, I mean, this seems to be very artificial. In some sense, I want to give you an idea of what is this quantity here. Now, from a mathematical point of view, I cannot resist, I have to say. What you find here is not necessarily a constant. In general, it is a resistance curve, as we have seen. And you can define it by this variational formula. So somehow you know this and this guy, you know this guy, and this guy is what you should put here, let's say in the denominator, in order to make this limit consistent. Okay, now, but there is actually one interesting point, is that when you have convergence of the energy release, or the derivative of the energy, then what you get as effective fracture is the maximum of the two, which I think is a good news, because it means that if you layer a material with a high toughness, with a material with a low toughness, what you get in the limit in average is a material which is inheriting the good property of the high toughness of the two, okay? So this is good. And the point is that mathematically, this is not always the case. It is really very, very special. In general, it is not. Now, let me also quote that in the combination of evolution and homogenization is really tricky, okay? And there is a very nice example of Tartar in the 90s showing a very strange effect of memory due to homogenization. Now, I want to conclude with an example. An example, it is one of those cases in which I can do an explicit computation of this effective toughness in the limit. Now, and this is the case of the layup. The layup, remember, is the case in which we have a material which is just you have a layering which is obtained just rotating. Now, if you have a layup and you rotate by pi over 2, you end up with this condition on the coefficient, just to change the 2 in the matrix. And then in this case, you can perform some computation and you get that the effective toughness is indeed a constant. It's not so in general a function, which takes this form. Now, what you see here is the following. It is depending on the volume fractions, lambda and 1 minus lambda, the toughness of the material, but also on the elastic contrast, okay? So this explains, in some sense, in this example, why you can have toughening, which means an increase of toughness just by layering materials with different elastic constant, which is very, it is very strange. I mean, now I have a proof, but I am still surprised of this, to be honest. And indeed, if additionally here you assume this relationship on the coefficient, then you end up that this is even greater than the maximum of the two. So this is really the toughening effect that we have seen in the experimental setup of Bhattacharya and Bourdain and others. Okay, I think my time is over, right? I cannot hear. I think you are muted.
Thank you, Matteo, for your talk. I open it for discussions, for questions. Are there questions to Matteo?
No, I don't know if...
you said that he could not hear you.
Can you? Okay.
Now I can.
Can you hear? Okay, I'm sorry.
Yes.
Can you hear us?
Yes, now I can.
So thank you for the talk. Are there questions to Matteo? Matteo, I have two naive questions and I have to apologize in advance for them. You showed this layered material with two elastic, was it a mu one A and mu one B, A and B phases. So, yes. So I'm asking, I see the length here, lots of, now you look only to the number of layers going to say infinity. But can you also scale this this constant mu with n? So can you handle, for instance, the high contrast? Maybe yes. It makes no sense, maybe fractures appear immediately.
No, you.
I don't know.
You can do it. Yes, you can do it. The contrast can be high, low, or depending on n.
Yeah.
It is not important. So, in some sense, this is the easiest setting that you can imagine. You can make everything depending on n. It is not that important. The formula
will change.
That you see here. Basically remains the same, okay, if you can compute a good homogenized energy. So the formula will be the same. This is indeed is quite general. Of course, the point is that then maybe you are not able to get explicit computations. This is the point, because at the end, you know, in applications, we are really interested in knowing what is the constant to put there, okay?
Okay.
And if this is the question, then it gets very complicated.
So I understand. So okay. So now my second question. You may have heard it in a different context. How do you know that the fracture model is a good one?
Sorry.
Okay. You work on fractures, right?
Yes.
Work on fractures. How do you know when a fracture model is a good one? Is a good model.
Okay, this is
of course, I understand it's a good model. You can do asymptotics.
Yeah.
You can do asymptotics,
yeah.
But yeah. So does it make it a good model?
Okay.
Or does it make it a good model?
Okay. Yeah. Let me go back.
How can I check it? That's correct.
Yeah. Now the standard of ASTM. Yeah. This is one of the standard which is coded in order to compute the toughness, okay? So ASTM is saying basically you have to compute this. Now, from my point of view, this model is good until the fracture moves along this line here, okay? When you have this big discontinuity here and big discontinuity here, it is not a good model. And indeed, ASTM is preventing this effect. Okay, so if you start from an initial fracture which is quite long, you won't see this initial discontinuity, and you will just see this quite steady state propagation. This is called. So this is what I would say is a good, I mean, is some sense of criteria. The point is that, of course, the alternative is to go into the fully dynamic model, where you will see a lot of waves departing from the crack tip. The point is that then homogenizing a dynamic model seems to be really a nightmare, because you will get a lot of reflection and refraction at each layer. So I'm afraid that it will be basically impossible. And in some sense, you want to fit into this Griffith criterion as much as you can. This is what I understood somehow from the applications.
Thanks a lot, Matteo. I think I understand your answer. Thank you very much.
Okay.
Welcome. Are there other questions to Matteo? If this is not the case, Matteo, thank you for your talk.
Thanks.
Bye-bye. Thank you. Okay. And the next is Rossi. Is she here?
Yes, so I'm trying to. So I have to share my desktop.
Yes.
Right. And then I'll open the file. Sorry, but I want to go back. Sorry.
Okay.
Can you see everything? Yeah?
Yes, we don't. Yeah, thank you. We see the screen. It's all fine.
And you can hear me.
We can hear you. Yes. Now we can also see you. Now it's okay. It's okay. We are all fine.
Okay.
Ricardo, thanks for being with us. The floor is yours, please. 25 minutes, preferably. Okay.
Thanks a lot. And thanks a lot for the introduction, and thanks a lot for the invitation to this workshop. So this talk today is somehow a continuation of Giovanna Bonsfanti's talk yesterday, because the focus is still on adhesive contact or other delamination models. And actually, we want to study a dimensional reduction problem for a delamination system. This is work in progress together with Giovanna and with Elisa Davoli from Vienna. Okay, so let me show you more precisely the geometry of the problem we want to address. So we start by considering delamination between two three-dimensional bodies that are in adhesive contact along a common part of their boundary. So these two bodies, you may think of them as being glued together along a common part of their boundary. This common part is a fixed surface, and it's going to be called the delamination surface, gamma C. Yesterday, you saw in Giovanna's talk how it is possible to model delamination, so rupture or degradation of the bonding between the two bodies, how it is possible to model this from a mathematical point of view. And now we are interested in adding an additional feature to this model, namely studying how this model behaves when you allow the thickness of the two bodies, epsilon, going to zero. So the geometry is precisely that described in this cartoon. And in particular, you have to take into account that the delamination surface will be positioned vertically in the direction where the thickness shrinks. So we want to study, from a mathematical point of view, how the adhesive contact model that Giovanna presented you yesterday behaves when epsilon goes to zero. And hopefully in this way we will derive a model for delamination between two-dimensional plates that are glued along a curve. Gamma C with the small gamma is somehow the limit of the delamination surface that we see, that we have seen for epsilon strictly positive. You may also think of the two-dimensional problem as a problem modeling the propagation of a crack along a fixed curve, which is this small gamma C. Okay, so this is the target of the talk. Let me, but before going to the dimensional reduction, I will briefly say something about the three-dimensional model. So the one with the fixed positive thickness when epsilon is strictly positive. And in particular, we will see that from a mathematical point of view, this model is a rate-dependent, rate-independent system. It's a coupled rate-dependent independent system, and it needs to be weakly formulated through the notion of energetic solution. And working from a mathematical point of view with this notion, I will address the dimensional reduction. Okay, so now we are back to the three-dimensional case. So the thickness epsilon is fixed. And you see a poorly handmade cartoon of the situation we have in mind. The two bodies are subject to viscosity and also to inertia. And as you saw yesterday in Giovanna's talk, the problem of delamination can be mathematical modeled as the evolution of two variables, the displacement field, and please keep in mind this notation for the jump of the displacement across the delamination surface, and a second variable, which is also called a internal variable in some literature. This is a delamination parameter that describes the state of the adhesive bonds on gamma C. So while the displacement lives in three dimensions on the union of the two bodies, let's say, this delamination variable lives on a two-dimensional domain, the surface. And of course, these two variables are also functions of time. This delamination variable is a damage-like parameter, and in fact, one may think of this problem as a surface damage problem. And it takes usually values between 0 and 1, where the threshold value 1 stands for the case in which at a certain point X of the delamination surface, at a certain process time T, all the bondings are intact, while the other threshold value 0 stands for the case in which the bonding is completely ruptured. The evolution of the delamination can be mathematically modeled by coupling the momentum balance with a suitable rule that tells us how the delamination variable evolves. And in engineering, it is also called a flow rule. The momentum balance is what you saw yesterday in Giovanna's talk. So we are considering, as I said, viscoelastic bodies. So we have a viscosity tensor here, and we are also considering inertial effects. This momentum balance in the union of the two bodies is coupled with the suitable Dirichlet and Neumann conditions on the Dirichlet and on the Neumann part of the union of the two bodies, which do not intersect the delamination surface. And in particular, we can consider an applied traction on the Neumann part, time-dependent Dirichlet loading on the Dirichlet part. And as you saw yesterday, we have also boundary conditions on the delamination surface. Giovanna explained to you yesterday that these boundary conditions on the delamination surface can be thought of as modified Signorini conditions, like Signorini conditions. These conditions on gamma C are responsible for enforcing non-interpenetration. This is the non-interpenetration condition between the two bodies. But they are modified in the sense that they feature this additional blue term, which is one of the terms that provide the coupling between the evolution of the displacement and the evolution of the delamination variable. We will see the corresponding of this blue term in the flow rule for the delamination variable. And this is, throughout the talk, for simplicity, in any case, I'm going to drop the applied traction and the time-dependent Dirichlet loading. So I'll take them equal to zero. But they could be considered, of course, non-constant. Okay, so what is the flow rule that describes, what is the flow rule that describes the evolution of the delamination variable? It is this subdifferential inclusion, which can be again thought as a balance of forces, as a balance between frictional forces that are in the subdifferential of the dissipation potential. So these frictional forces are related to dissipation. And you may think of this subdifferential, which is a mathematical object, as a proxy for the derivative when the derivative cannot be taken. This is the dissipation potential that describes how energy is dissipated by the system, and it is also responsible for enforcing the constraint that the time derivative of the delamination variable is negative, so the delamination variable decreases. In other words, the bonding is a unidirectional, irreversible phenomenon. So this is irreversibility. We have a regularizing gradient term. We may have a regularizing gradient term, but I'm not really focusing on this throughout the talk. I will say something about this at the very end. And we have this blue term, which is related to the blue term that we have seen in the Signorini conditions, and that again provides the coupling between the evolution of Z and the evolution of U. But actually, what I really want to focus on in this slide is the fact that the dissipation potential here is a positive homogeneous of degree one. You can see it. It's a modulus. So if you compute R at lambda Z dot, this lambda goes out of the modulus, provided it is positive. The fact that lambda goes out of the modulus is called, is a mathematical property called homogeneity, positive homogeneity, because lambda has to be positive. Okay, this positive homogeneity has important consequences. First of all, it tells us that this equation is invariant for time rescalings. So if you rescale U, and if you accordingly rescale Z, the rescale Z will be a solution of the rescaled problem. And this is why we call this kind of evolution rate independent. There's a dramatic difference here from the models that Giovanna presented you yesterday, which are rate dependent models. The dramatic difference is, of course, mathematically speaking, because one of the consequences of rate independence from a mathematical point of view is that Z as a function of time has low regularity. In particular, as a function of time, it is just BV of bounded variation, which means that Z as a function of time may jump, which means that as a mathematician, I'm not really allowed to write this equation pointwise. And I have to intend this equation, I have to formulate this equation in a weak way because this derivative needn't exist because Z as a function of time may jump. Okay, so this is an overview of our PD system. So the momentum balance coupled with supplemented by its boundary conditions, the condition on the contact surface that couple the momentum balance with the flow rule for Z, and finally the flow rule for Z, which is posed on the contact surface. This system has a mixed character. It is, in some sense, rate independent in the evolution of Z and rate dependent because it features viscosity and inertia in the evolution of U. How can we properly formulate it in a weak way? Well, one possibility is to resort to the concept of energetic solution, which was advanced more than 20 years ago by now by Alexander Milke and his group, and in parallel also by Gianni Dalmaso, who's a mathematician in Trieste. Okay, in order to formulate energetic solutions in this context, we have to specify a little bit the energetics of this system. So we have to reveal the fact that this system can be written as a system of two subdifferential inclusions that features a driving energy functional. So the overall mechanical energy of the system, which counts the elastic energy, the volume force that we see here, and this is a term that relates to the impenetrability constraint, and finally the blue term, the coupling term that gives the coupling between the evolutions of U and Z. This is can be thought of as an adhesive energy. And the other two guys that you see here, this is simply inertia. The other two guys that you see here are the dissipation potentials. So the one homogeneous dissipation potential that enters in the evolution of Z, and the viscous dissipation potential, you see here the viscosity tensor that enters in the damped evolution of U. Okay, and now that you have all this notation for the energies at play in our model, now you can formulate it in a weak way using this concept, which was extended to mixed rate independent evolution by Tomasz Rubicek. So how can we properly formulate in a weak way this system? We will formulate the momentum balance for U in a standard variational way through test functions, and we will couple it with a semi-stability condition and with an energy dissipation balance. Let's just take a moment to understand them. Okay, so what you can see below is a heuristic justification of the semi-stability condition. But what I would like to emphasize is that this semi-stability condition is strongly related to the fact that the evolution of Z is rate independent. Why do we call it a stability condition? Because it tells us that when you want to switch from the current state of your evolution ZT to any other possible state of the evolution, Z tilde, then you get a release of energy, this quantity that you can see on the left-hand side, that it is in any case smaller than the energy that you dissipate. So you gain energy, you get a release of energy that is smaller than the energy you dissipate. So it's not really convenient to switch from ZT to ZT. You'd better stay in ZT. This is a semi-stability condition in any case, because you can see that UT, the current displacement, is not compared to another displacement in the state for displacements. UT is kept fixed, okay? The other ingredient is an energy dissipation balance. And actually, this is again, something close to what you have seen in Matteo's talk, because we have here a balance between the energy stored at time t and the energy at the initial time. What we also see here on the left-hand side is the kinetic energy and the dissipated energy. You also had a dissipated energy in Matteo's talk. The dissipated energy due to the dissipation of energy in U and due to the dissipation of energy in Z. So again, this is a mathematical object related to the one homogeneous dissipation. This is balanced with the initial kinetic energy, the initial stored energy, and the work of the external forces. Okay. We have an energetic solution in this sense for the 3D model, the one with the epsilon strictly positive, fixed thickness. And now we want to go to the limit. So we want to perform this dimensional reduction analysis. And now we can be a little bit more precise on the kind of problem we want to address. So for epsilon fixed, we will get an energetic solution through to the 3D delamination system. An energetic solution is a pair U epsilon Z epsilon. And now you want to consider the limit when epsilon vanishes, and then you wonder whether this pair, which now forms a sequence of solutions depending on epsilon, will converge as epsilon goes to zero to something. And if this something, if this pair of functions U and Z will solve a limiting problem, okay, hopefully it will solve something. And this limiting problem could be interpreted as a model for delamination between two dimensional plates. Actually, I have to say that this kind of analysis was already carried out 10 years ago by another Freddy, not Francesco, but Lorenzo, together with Roberto Paroni, Tomasz Lubicek, and Chiara Zanini in the fully rate independent case. So in the case where the displacement is at elastic equilibrium and no viscosity and no inertia is incorporated in the model. So the model is fully rate independent. While we were curious to see whether something could be said for the mixed case. Okay, let me be again a little bit more precise about the dimensional reduction. So we will consider for every epsilon, so a sequence of energetic solutions to the delamination systems with thickness epsilon going to zero, fulfilling the delamination, the semi-stability condition with this driving energy. And here the focus is on this quadratic form that features a different scalings of the different scaling of the components of the jump of U. This scaling is motivated by mathematical reasons, because we want to see something non-trivial in the limit epsilon goes to zero. It can be interpreted in any case from the modeling point of view by imagining that one has a different rigidity in the in-plane directions and in the out-of-plane directions. Okay. So the way one carries out this dimensional reduction is pretty standard in some sense, because what you want to get rid of is the fact that you are working on a moving spatial domain. So the domains here, the epsilon domains vary as epsilon go to zero. And this is an additional mathematical difficulties. You have a sequence of solutions that live on varying domains. And you want to get rid of this. And to get rid of this through a rescaling, you transform the problem into a problem on a fixed domain. And from now on, we work on this fixed domain, which is again three-dimensional. It's the rescaled domain. This is the rescaling mapping that goes from the rescaled domain back to the vanishing thickness domain. And this is the rescaling mapping that allows us to transform the problem on the varying domain to a problem on the fixed domain. Okay, so the next slide is a little bit technical. It tells us how we transform the functions, the solutions U epsilon and Z epsilon. So U epsilon and Z epsilon are the solutions on the varying domain where epsilon goes to zero, and we rescale them suitably. We rescale them not only spatially, but also temporally. So we also rescale time. You see here that we divide the time variable by epsilon. Again, this time rescaling is a common procedure for dimensional reductions in dynamic problems. And now we get the rescaled pair, which is in a different font and in a different color. And what one has to take into account is that this rescaled pair now lives on a fixed spatial domain, omega and gamma c for z epsilon. Okay, and then what do? We simply write rewrite the notion of energetic solution in terms of this rescaled pair, and we pass to the limit in this notion of energetic solution using tools from calculus of variations and compactness arguments. Okay, so maybe I won't really comment this slide. What I will just say this, that the focus of this slide was in particular on how the momentum balance looks like after this rescaling procedure. And in particular, what I would like to stress is that here we no longer have the linearized symmetric strain tensor that one would have in the standard weak formulation of the momentum balance, but we have a modified differential operator that takes into account the rescaling. You see here the effect of the rescaling, and you see the effect of the rescaling on these rows and on this row and on this column. This is of course related to the fact that your thickness goes to zero in the direction of x3, so in the what we called in the out of plane direction. While the submatrix that corresponds to the in-plane direction is left the same. Okay? And then this is the statement of the result. So remember the in-plane directions, the directions of the plane where the two-dimensional plate sits and the out-of-plane direction. This result tells us to what the pair of rescaled solutions converge as epsilon goes to zero. It converges to a pair of functions that are defined on omega for u, and sorry, there's a typo, of course, z is still defined just on the delamination surface. And we want to understand what are the features of this pair u and z. Okay, first of all, the limiting displacement is of Kirchhoff-Love type, which means that it has a special representation in terms of the Kirchhoff-Love components, the two functions u bar and u3. U is a vector, okay? The first two components encoded in the vector u bar have these properties that...
Ricarda?
Yes, it's Ricarda. Just... yes.
Half a minute.
Yeah, it's the last slide, sorry. Okay. It's really the last slide. So u is... my computer has slowed down. Okay, I'm sorry, you are seeing, I'm sorry, just a moment.
You seem to be busy.
No, I have this bad habit of never closing PDF files. This is my bad habit, I'm sorry. So I just wanted to say that in the first two components, u is an affine function of the out-of-plane variable, x3, while the out-of-plane component u3 is a function just of the in-plane variables. So we have this special feature of the displacement that is related to the fact that we come from a dimensional reduction procedure. This dimensional reduction procedure is also seen in the limiting momentum balance, which just features the in-plane symmetrized strain tensor and a reduced elasticity tensor. They are coupled with the semi-stability and with a suitable energy dissipation balance. Okay, the very last remark was really a technical one, and I will skip it. Thanks for your attention.
Thank you very much.
Oh, sorry, I cannot see you. And
you cannot see me. Oh, this is a...
No, I can't see you. And okay, maybe now I can see you. Yes. I can see you.
You can also hear us, right? So, thank you for the talk. Is there a short question for Ricarda, please? It's coming. There, it's coming. Yeah, it's okay.
Hi, Ricarda. Thank you for the talk. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. I didn't get why. You keep the inertia only for the third component of the displacement in the
This is mathematical. This is related to the fact that we have scaled the time in a certain way.
Yeah, but why is it necessary to scale the time in the first two components and not in the third one?
Yeah, this is this scaling is something that is accepted for this dimensional reduction. Okay, first of all, of course, is mathematically driven, but the argument that can justify it is that oscillations occur at such a slow time scale that in order to see something in the vanishing thickness limit, you need to rescale time too.
Okay, so there is also a, say, mechanical meaning in this, no? It's not only...
it is related, everything is somehow related, yes.
Okay, Thank you, Ricardo.
You're welcome.
Thank you, Ricardo. Thank you.
Bye-bye. You're welcome. Yeah.
Hello.
Hello, can you hear us?
Yes, I can hear you. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you. Now let's see if we can see your slides. Can you
please? Not yet, because not yet.
One
shared my screen. So
yes,
can you see?
Yes, we can see the slides. We can hear you, we can see the slides.
Okay.
Thank you very much for being with us. The floor is yours.
Okay. Thank you to you.
25 minutes, please, so that we can ask also some questions, Silvia. Thank you.
Okay. I don't see if you see I'm full screen or not.
Not full screen.
I try because it seems okay. Now it's full screen.
Yes, now it's full screen. Thank you.
Okay, so today, thank you for the introduction. Today, in this presentation, I want to show you some tools based on geometry and algebraic, so a bit different from PDE and numerical analysis for reasoning about shapes with an application on contour edge. In particular, I've organized my talk trying to introduce you the problem of similarity reasoning, in particular focusing on the field of cultural heritage, because it is typical reasoning of computer vision necessary also in cultural heritage, and how it can support the quantification of similarities and difference between models. Then I will give you some of the tools we use to reason about similarity between objects and in particular between fragments. And we will overview some of the mathematical properties we use, some of the tools in terms of computational topology, in terms of algebraic, and of characterization, local characterization we can adopt. In the end, I will show you some of the results. So I will skip several details, technical details, but we'll give you some results we obtained in the last years, reasoning and quantifying the similarity between fragments. Discussion in particular on the ongoing research on artificial intelligence on this field are also discussed in the end. So let's start showing and introducing the problem from our point of view. From our point of view, the object of our research is to identify a set of shape correspondence between two models, for instance, to identify or to automatically associate an handle of a vase to another handle to a vase, or identifying a part of a model because of the same style, of the same characteristics of another model, even if they have different functionalities, or to simply give a score of a similarity. When by V giving a score of similarity is to get a collection of artifacts. In this case, these artifacts are from a museum from the North America. And here there are several vases, there are pots, there are jars. And the idea is to find some correspondence related to their function, maybe the geometry, the style, the material, the decoration they have on top. And giving a score means associating a number. this number, of course, is not the truth, is not an absolute number. It depends in general on the meaning and on the, our goals in that moment. In general, it's necessary to index these shapes. For instance, we are building a collection of 3D models, and we want to provide to the user a collection of models ranked by similarity, like for instance when we have a ranking on the Google page. So Google 3D models, Google for cultural heritage. Again, speaking about similarity, I want to just to show you by images what is the problem, because these objects, are they similar or not? In which sense I are similar? For instance, if in these 12 objects, if I select these models, from the geometrical point of view, they are not the same because they have a bit different parts or statues, but they have the same functionality and they all represent feet. As you can see, is it impossible to reason only on geometry if you want to identify these parts, these fragments of an object as feet, because we need also to understand something more related to the fact they have both a digit, they have the same position maybe in the model and so on. Similarly, here I'm showing to you some example of heads. Again, since we are dealing with fragment, the overall shape sometimes is not enough to reason about similarity, because we can have a full head or a mask-like head or only parts, because damage, time, different occasions made them this model broken. And in the end, when we speak about decoration, we can have shapes with very different geometric shape, but with the same decoration, painted or chiseled on the model. So how to deal with this puzzle and with this complexity of questions? What you have proposed at IMATI during years is a set of tools based on geometry, geometry meaning overall shape, also features, patterns, decoration, feature curves, and also on colors. And the challenge is how to combine them, and in particular, how we can deal with geometric properties that are important but are not enough to reason about the similarity in this field. And to give also multi-scale description, because sometimes changing scale, the meaning of decoration, the meaning of part can change interpretation. So we need a multi-layered description. It is important to be insensitive to the choice of a coordinate system, because objects are not in the same position. So we don't know in general in which position are found this fragment. And indeed, we need to replace maybe fragment we have found in some template, in some more general model. It's important to be robust to noise, because real data are damaged, decoration are often damaged by time, color have changed, chiselation sometimes become smooth. So it's important that small changes in the shape, more changes in the color that are abraded, for instance, correspond to small changes in the descriptors. And in the end, it is important for us to decompose these objects in primitives, in parts that are relevant, because sometimes we look for correspondence between parts of a model and not everything, because sometimes the decoration are not in the overall model, but also only on some parts. So let's start with some of the ingredients we found important for our analysis and important for the developing tools. First of all, one thing we noticed, it is important when dealing particularly with statuing, is the thickness. In general, we notice that the fragments that share the same thickness are more likely to belong to compatible shapes. Not, of course, the same, because there are artifacts in the same style, but in any case, is a first filter if two objects have a different thickness to exclude sometimes they are not in the same collection. Another important point to reason if two fragments belong to the same vase or to the same statuing is if they have some curvature continuity, or if they have a similar roughness, and if they have similar decoration, or compatible, of course, decorations. This means the ingredient, the geometric ingredients important for our analysis are thickness, are curvature, and curvature-related indices, are colors, decorations, and so on. In mathematical terms, we translated these properties in terms of scalar properties. When we speak about thickness or curvature, in general, we reason in terms of a scalar value associated to the space. And the two most common curvature description we use are, in general, the mean curvature and the shape index. In particular, the shape index is interesting because it's an index in ranges in the interval -1, 1, so it's a bounded interval where belonging to the different part of intervals has a meaning in terms of convexity, concavity, flatness, and so on. So there is a correspondence in the range of intervals of a value of a point and the meaning of a local geometry of a shape in a neighborhood of that point. But also we need to deal not only with a scalar, but also with vector valued functions. One of the most famous and relevant scalar vector valued function we use are colors. Colors are naturally represented with more channels, and we can represent color channels in terms of a three-dimensional function. Here I'm showing to you an example of one colored model decomposed in three channels, in this case the CLab channels. I will explain later, it is our favorite representation space for colors. So I showed you the properties. To model in our representation of the problem, we need also a space. In general, when we reason about shape, we reason about a topological space equipped with a property. We have a same property, we need to know what is the topological space. In terms of a topological space, the descriptors we had need to deal with a large range of input, because sometimes we can have an image. For instance, we have images in terms of photograph, but also we have many sketch. In cultural heritage, there is a lot of tradition of representing artifact with sketches and line drawing. Or we can have images sometimes taken with a false color, because maybe we have taken some images representing some properties. The most familiar for us representation is the surfaces, where by surfaces we can have a point cloud, so acquisition from laser scanning or for photogrammetric techniques, or meshes, where someone, maybe us, have already reconstructed the model in a 3D model, and the most common tessellation we use are triangular mesh, but we could have also other kind of tessellation. And here I'm showing to you some example of surfaces. We can also have volumes. In this case, we need particular acquisition techniques, or what is more interesting in the case of cultural heritage, when we have depicted models, we can have the combination of surfaces and color, where the color is a texture or something applied to the vertices of a model. And we can have a color almost uniform, or decoration, or some part decorated, some part are uniform. Just to start, we have properties, we have a topological space, how to combine them to build an abstract representation. An abstract representation for us in general is a description which is more simple than the full object, but in any case is a description significant of the property of the object we are considering. The first tool we developed in collaboration with the University of Bologna and Reggio Emilia are the use of persistent homology. In particular, we considered the inclusion map. I'm showing here three example of signals, but we can adopt the same reasoning to surfaces and volumes. And looking at this curve, the signal representing the image from left to right, we can imagine we visit this curve from the minimum to the maximum, like immerging this in a fluid. There is a natural inclusion between the sub-level set of the first curve to the middle one and to the rightmost one, and passing to the homological group, we have the same an inclusion too. The persistent homology encodes the rank of the images of a group of homology of a sub-level set when the value of z, in the sense of the u, increases. The rank of this space are the Betti numbers. There are results, theoretical results, showing the Betti number as robust to perturbations. So this means that we have a different curve, slightly different curve, ranging in an interval of confidence. Also the representation, here I'm showing to you the diagram of a best instance, are quite very close. So small modification of the input occur with small modification of a descriptor. Persistence is particularly important for dealing with scalar and vector function and for dealing global reasoning, global comparison. For dealing with local analysis, we chose the different strategy. We chose to analyze the neighbor of points of our topological space. We were inspired from the well-known local binary pattern, very famous in the field of images, and we extended it to meshes and to point cloud. We named Edge LPB MLPB because the first one in the case of meshes counts the intersection of an hypothetic sphere around the point and take into account the variation around this point, working on the intersection of the sphere and edges. In the case of a point cloud, we project on the plane, on the fitting plane, the point cloud, and we counted the different elevation. What you obtained is analogous of a representation of a neighbor of a LBP pattern, and from this we can extract an operator counting the variation around the points in the arc. This is in some sense, an extension of a tool for texture analysis to the variation in a 3D model in a surface. And in the end, another tool used, preferring this to the classical splines, is the half-transform. Half-transform, in our case, is considered in the extension proposed by Beltrametti e Robbiano 9 years ago, where the classical half-transform, I think most of us know it as an important detector of line and circles, and ellipses was extended to the recognition of all algebraic surfaces. So adding a large dictionary of possible curves to the half-transform tool. Just to give you a flavor, because the tools we are using are rooted in algebraic geometry, we exploit in general the duality between curve and line, thinking to the straight line, because it is your example. We know that in a straight line there are infinite points, but there is also the duality that in a point passes infinite straight lines. The idea when ranging in general curves is exactly the same. Here I'm showing three points in a curve, P1, P2, and P3. In the dual of a parameter spaces, imposing the curves in a family of spaces passed in P1, for instance, means having a line of parameters in the curve space. If there is a solution, if these points belong to the one ideal curve, the ideal curve has the parameters of intersection of the all lines passing between these points in the space of parameters. Without going in detail, the idea is, because we are dealing with not infinite or continuous space, but we are dealing with a finite number of sampling in general, is to vote the points of our domain, how many times or how many function passes in this point. This becomes in a matrix, it becomes in a voting on the space of parameter spaces, and the maxima are the functions, are the curve more likely pass in all of the points in the domain. Of course, given a family, many solutions can be possible. This is our contribution on this, is we understood that persistence can give us an answer also in this case, because peaks with high persistence are more likely the best solution of our problem. And and another point is to assess, to distinguish between the among the solution provided us by the half transform, a quality of a measure of a goodness of a fit. And we introduced several measures to assess the quality of the fitting. So I introduced you the tools. And now I want to give you some ideas of the results and how ideal in practice with them to reason and to build something more complex. So we have local and global descriptions we need to combine them because they represent sometimes a different scale in geometry or represent different properties, different color. And if we want to build an interface, a way to show you the results in unique rank, we will need to combine the similarity scores we have obtained from the different ingredients. As I said, geometric properties for us are handling the Euclidean space, and the photometric properties are handling the CLab space. Because from the experiment, we found that the CLab space is the most close in the, with a human intuition. Even if the CLab space is an hyperbolic space, there are perception studies showing that the Euclidean distance in the CLab space find closest points that are also closest for the human intuition. Just an example to give you how to we combine how we deal with a global descriptor. For us, dealing for photometric comparisons means combining in general two or more descriptors, one based on persistent diagram spaces, where we analyze.
Silvia, 1 minute, please.
Okay. I was too long, sorry.
You would like okay. to say example, but 1 minute.
Yes, okay. But now I have a more example. I try to be fast as possible. So
oh, no, show us an example, yeah.
Yes, exactly. So I was saying we are combining persistence diagram and space with histograms. This is significant and this is necessary because the persistence and space is robust to noise, but I mentioned that persistence is sensitive to a minima, so to black holes. In this case, for instance, in the second case, the persistence space can be different even if the two models are similar. But in this case, we can have a contribution from histograms. And so we are able also, I try, with the local descriptor I showed to you, it's possible to compare objects with patterns. And in particular, not only comparing full object, but also to segment and to build and to feed social, cioè artificial deep learning networks like ResNet, and to obtain a classification on the shape and on the local shape of the object. And this is for us important because it is an ongoing work on similarity and artificial intelligence. And this is the last. It was the one on artificial intelligence saying we noticed that the generalization in any case a bit complex because in a case of cultural heritage we don't have many examples and artificial net needs many examples to learn, for instance different scales, different decoration and so on. So I stop here.
Thank you, Silvia. Thank you for your nice talk. Okay. I think you have convinced us that even the simple question of checking whether two objects are similar or self-similar or not similar, it's not so trivial task to do. Pity that you're not with us so that you can show us more of these examples you have on your computer. But I'm opening the talk to questions. Other questions in the audience? I have just a very short one. Are you doing this multi-scale data decomposition? Are you also doing these kind of things?
Yes. Yes. In the sense, I mentioned just in the we are trying to decompose the models and to find similar parts between different objects. For instance, finding parts with the same style, like the beard in the model or the cap, because, and to understand if we have different styles. The point is how to combine them. It's also this field of research, because depending on the user needs, maybe we need to give more emphasis to some properties instead of the others, for instance to the chiselation or to decoration and so on.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you for being
You're
with
welcome.
Us. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Goodbye.
We move now to Christos Nikolopoulos.
Hello, you hear me, I guess.
Christos, we can hear you. Christos, can you see us?
Yes, fine. I should share my screen now.
Can you please try to share your screen? Are you in Athens or on Samos Island?
I'm in Athens.
So, can you please share the slides?
Okay. Wait.
Thank you very much. All looks good.
Okay. You must be able to see it now, I guess.
No, but that's okay. It's fine. Christos, it would be great if you would stick to 25 minutes so that we can ask you some questions at the end.
Yeah, I'll try to.
Okay. The floor is yours, Christos. Please start.
Okay, thank you. I want to thank you a lot for the invitation in this very interesting workshop. Well, the title of my talk is going to be Macroscopic Models for Calcium Carbonate Corrosion due to Sulfation. The idea here is to see how in the case that we have sulfation in and consequently corrosion in material that it's that consists from calcite, how you can derive macroscopic models by considering the microstructure of the material. Okay, of course we are going to talk about a material that it's porous, it has porosity. The of course an application for such basic application is of course to see, to count somehow the way how the corrosion evolves in a monument. That's basic. There is a lot of interest for something like this also in here in Greece. Note that the motivation by this work comes from initially from these papers and of course all the relevant papers regarding this kind of monument corrosion, and the idea is to was to combine it actually with this with this work by Andrew Lacy and Louis Carey, which they consider a certain way of deriving macroscopic models from microstructure consideration. This was done, of course, in the case of Stefan problems for melting, but there are a lot of similarities in this case. So, as it's mentioned before, the basic reaction that is considered here is the one that sulfate dioxide reacts with calcium carbonate and forms gypsum in the presence of water. And one way to model this is to assume that you have, for example, a limestone, a material that it's from limestone or similar, something similar, that it's it has some porosity. So you have diffusion inside the pores of the sulfur dioxide, and U stands for the concentration of it. And Also in the surface of the solid skeleton inside the pores, you have a reaction taking place, which by the law of mass action must have this kind of form. W stands for the concentration of water. And also there is an additional function G here saying that you must have at least a threshold for the reaction to start. You must have enough humidity. This is what it says here. And the rate of reaction is proportional to the speed of the moving boundary, which is shows how the solid skeleton is shrinking and gypsum is formed. We have similar equations for the water here, the concentration for water. Also to note, all we have this Robin condition describing the flow of the reactants in the boundary, in the surface. So more or less, this is the idea. The equations are in the scale form here. And okay, and now we have to focus a bit in the material, the geometry, because we need to make quite a few assumptions in order to be able to treat mathematically the problem. We assume that through the porous material and due to its porosity, we have cracks existing in it. And diffusion of the sulfur dioxide inside the calcite. So we have the reaction taking place initially the cracks in a surface, gypsum is formed, and then we have in this local area there, an area that it's consists of gypsum and vacuum. Now, we assume also that the bulk of the material under study consists of uniform cells that are filled with calcium carbonate. And we idealize things here as saying that these cells are maybe cubical if we want to consider a three-dimensional microstructure, or cells of square shape. This is going to what I'm going to present in the next of the talk, or even to have something similar, even line segments. In general, we assume that we have an infinite set of square cell in our case inside the material. Okay, and the calcite inside it, we assume now, it's a bit crude assumption, but again, it's convenient to do so, that it, this is placed symmetrically inside the cell. Okay, while the rest of the pore, the rest of the cell is void, filled with water or air. Also, to make a note here, in the rest of the analysis, I'm not going to consider volume expansion, which is an effect of the difference of the porosity between the calcite and the material and the gypsum that it's formed, but I'm going to add it later on the numerics I'm going to show in the final part of the talk. Okay, this is done for simplicity. Okay, so more or less, this is the image I was trying to describe before. We have these bars, solid bars that it's the skeleton of the material somehow. We consider if we take an intersection here, we may divide it in square cells, which inside the cells we have the solid the solid material. Okay. Next, and more or less by making all these assumptions, we have an image form of how the process is. Initially, we have this uncorroded part of the material, which consists of the cells that no reactions has taken place. No reaction has taken place yet. The core is that black hole centered here. The solid core. Then, as we have diffusion of sulfur dioxide, we have reaction in the surface of the solid core, and then we have gypsum and voids are formed in the rest of the cell. Okay, and of course the core here is streaking, and finally when the reaction is we have the final part of the reaction where the calcite is there is no more calcite here, so this is going to give us an image like this, that we have the fully corroded. But so actually we are going to obtain moving boundary problems where here C separates uncorroded partly corroded area, B the full corroded and partly corroded area, and as I mentioned before, A may be also a moving boundary describing the swelling of the material. Now, in order to simplify a bit the presentation, I'm going to consider only one question for the reactant. Also that F here may be stand if we have a system in some kind of transfer between the reactants by Henry's law, etc. And so we have the field equation, we have the boundary condition at the interface. Also here, I assume again for simplicity that we have a first order reaction, and after appropriate scaling, we have only here the variable U. And we have this is the Robin condition about the flow in the boundary, and the kinetic condition of which tell us how the moving boundary evolves. Okay, so based on that, we may apply a homogenization procedure. Note here that the crucial variable is delta, which is the length of the microscopic scale over the the length of the microscopic length scale over the macroscopic length scale, and this ratio, of course, is small. Applying multiple scales, we get for the field equation the standard form in this kind, if you apply this kind of method, and we have also similar for the speed of the boundary given by this equation here. Note that S here is the surface of the streaking core of the solid. Okay, so this is the form that after multiple scales application that the kinetic condition takes, and also we need to impose some conditions in the cell boundary, in the square actually, which we impose periodic conditions. And in this case, for this certain type of condition, and for the square, these are maybe summed up to this Neumann condition here, no flux condition. We may apply standard asymptotic expansion of this form. We get the form of the field equation here, the kinetic condition, the Robin condition next, and the boundary condition in the cell boundary. If we separate our problems, we get two leading order terms that the concentration of the reactant actually doesn't depend in the macro scale. Y stands for the macroscopic scale, While the variable Z here is stands for the microscopic, is the microscopic variable. So at the first order terms, we have no dependence on Z, while we see this in the next order terms. So that complicates a bit things, and we have to treat this kind of dependence. We may notice that this comes from that the gradient is proportional to this quantity here, the gradient with respect to y of u naught, and so we may write u1 as product of w, a function that depends only on z, and the gradient of u naught. This results in this kind of problems, which is called the cell problems, for the cell problem for the for our full problem. And actually, this is the one describing the effect of the shape of the moving boundary inside the cell, finally in the diffusion coefficient of the macroscopic problem. Okay, so after the averaging, the macroscopic equation has this form. Note here that we have actually it's three problems somehow. We have this macroscopic field equation, but we have also to calculate D, the diffusion coefficient, which is variable. Also, we obtain this source term, which has to do with a reaction term. This that's why we see this u naught here. And this ratio, which is the arc length of the boundary over the area of the corroded part of the cell. Okay. Also, we have the equation for the motion of the boundary. And also, we have the cell problem. So I want to say a couple of things about the solution strategy now, which we are going to use it in order to obtain a numerical solution. The idea here is to solve these equations, the one for the kinetic condition here and the cell boundary separately. We do this by, note here that the problem has to be completed with appropriate initial and boundary condition. In the case of that we have one dimensional slab, we may have some kind of Dirichlet condition on the one side, no flux condition on the other side, plus some condition about the initial shape. Okay, and now coming back to what I wanted to say before, we have, okay, we use for the kinetic condition this transformation in time, so that the new variable of time is given by this integral, and in this way we get rid of the right hand side here and that u here, and we have only to solve the Econal equation, which can be solved independently. In particular, we also in some cases we have analytical solutions for this equation, the sat pile solutions. So if we start initially with a square, then we have just this square streaking in the center of the cell. The same happens if we have a cycle. This simplifies things because we now may have and more easy expressions for the arc length and the area of the corroded part of the cell. And we obtain finally a non-local problem to be solved. Okay, not also that we have to say something about the diffusion coefficient D here, but this is going to come next. The In the case that we don't have an initial nice shape, that we have an analytical solution, we may always treat, in most of the cases, treat the problem numerically. And for example, we may use the level set method for the Econel equation. Here is the relevant scheme, and to obtain the numerical solution. Here is an example for in the case that we have initial an ellipsoid describing the core, then this one is, according to the Econel equation, is streaking, the surface is streaking towards the center of the cell. Okay, now we have to feed this information back to the macroscopic equation. I don't want to say more things here, just to note that at each time step, the variable tau stands for time in the macroscopic problem. We may calculate this term here, and we may find the minimize the quantity this one and find the sigma, appropriate sigma, which is the time variable we used in the Econel equation. And then if we have a sequence of solutions for the surfaces, we may find the appropriate, we may pick the appropriate surface here, so, and calculate then L and A. Okay, so we use some kind of interpolation somehow. The other auxiliary problem we have is the cell problem. Here, the things are more standard. We use a final element method and we may and we solved the problem for various geometries. Here, in the case that we have a cyclic boundary, here in the case we have a square boundary, the same can be done if we have a different kind of geometry. So in this way, now we can also determine the diffusion coefficient. So we have the information about D here also for L and A, and we can proceed by using a final element scheme for the field equation and obtain the final result. Also note here that we may, it's not that difficult to make an addition and see how the volume expansion works. This is the one thing I mentioned before. In this case also, imagine that we have the square cell. If we assume again the kinetic condition here, we may find that we have a behavior that the square cell expands due to that this equation attains a sampai solution again. So we can add this to this model in the process to do the formal asymptotics is the same, and we come up with the final numerical result. Here is an example of such a numerical simulation. We have the concentration of the reactant in the left graph. While this one is more interesting, we may see the evolution of the boundary in four different times. We start with the initial slab here, it's uncorroded. If we go after some times, we may have a small swelling here. Part of the area of the slab is partly corroded. Till that green line here, till YLT, and that bit here is uncorroded. For a later time, this area is every part of the slab is partly corroded, while after some point the part of the area is fully corroded, and the right part here is it's fully corroded, while some other part is partly corroded till the corrosion is full. Okay, so just to finish with a note that this process can be adapted and studied in this way, similar system. One of them is that when we have sewer pipe corrosion, which the element here is cement, and we have sulfation due to sulfate acid here. Also, of course, this is similar if we consider some other situation like a monument that it's made of cement, as in this is mentioned also in other talks here. And also, I will mention another case that it's the case that we have another system, diffusion of colloids, again in porous medium. Adrian Muntean is going to talk to you about this tomorrow. Just to make, I want to make a note here. Again, we have diffusion of particles that that collide between them, and the other fact forming bigger clusters, and the other fact is that they deposit in the surface of an initial core, a solid core that exists in the porous medium. Okay, the geometry considerations here are similar as the one mentioned before. The reaction, the way that these collisions happen is given by the classical Smoluchowski form. And sorry, in our case, we have the solid core expanding now and tends to fill the whole cell of the, in our geometry, the whole tends to fill the whole cell. And in a low, in a similar kinetic equation as the one we had before. And also these questions here tell us how, in which form they, the particles are deposited in the surface of the solid skeleton. Okay, in this case also we made some two-dimensional macroscopic simulations.
Christos, 1 minute, please.
Yeah, yeah, just the last the last page. So here we started with some non-homogeneous R distribution. R stands for the radius of the solid core in one cell. We have meaning that we have a small space, lower space in the empty space in the cells here and here, and we may see also the diffusion in this square two-dimensional macroscopic area. We may see the evolution of the diffusivity, while at the end, for example, we may see here the evolution of R at the end of the simulation. Note that in these yellow areas here, for example, we have clogging, meaning the cells are full of material now and there is no space for diffusion. But we are going to hear more about this tomorrow. Okay, so just to mention a few publications my presentation. And okay, that's it. I want to thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Christos. Are there questions for Christos? Christos, I have a naive question. You had epsilon and delta as parameters for your starting model. Epsilon was a scaling.
Yes, I maybe the.
But
the symbol is not very good choice. I use that epsilon here is this is what you're asking, isn't it?
My question is
I just use that parameter here that which comes from the scaling of after appropriate scaling is not necessarily small. It might be in some cases that I was trying to take real numbers and see how to make a simulation closer to reality. It might happen in some cases that this parameter here might be also might be small. So in that case, we have some kind of quasi-state problem. But this is not the answer. This is not necessarily small.
Yeah, and my second question, I think it's on this slide. You have a free boundary problem for the pores, and that must scale somehow the normal velocity with the delta. And I think it was on that slide that you are order of delta, right? So as delta goes to zero, somehow the growth is smaller and smaller, slower and slower. On the previous slide, I guess, on the one you want with the epsilon. When you add the epsilon, the one you showed.
Okay, if epsilon is small, you can modify this process, and actually you get with a field equation that doesn't have the time derivative.
Okay. Okay, thank you. So it doesn't play a special role.
Not really. It's not that crucial.
Okay, thank you. Bye bye.
Yes. I stop sharing. Okay, thanks.
Bye bye, Christos. We go now to our last speaker of today. Fermo.
Yes, I am here. Good evening.
One more. Good evening. We do not see you yet.
Yes.
What do we do?
Will you see?
No. Okay. Yeah, yes, Paola. Fermo. Hi, Paola. We see you.
Hi. I try to share my presentation.
Please do. Excellent.
You can.
Yes, and now it's full screen.
Yes, it is.
Thank you very much. Yes.
Okay.
Yes. Thank you, Paola.
Thank you to you. The
floor is yours, please.
Yes, thank you. Thank you, first of all, for this kind invitation. I anticipate that I am not a mathematician, I am a chemist. And I will not show you any mathematical formula. So I will speak about this topic from the chemical point of view. So the topic of my presentation is the damage induced by atmospheric pollution on indoor heritage. I will speak in general of this problem, and then I will show you some case studies on which we have carried out our research. We know that as concerns indoor pollution, we have the effect of both indoor specific sources of pollutants and outdoor sources. The problem is an enormous problem, and atmospheric climate change, and in particular atmospheric pollution, deals with these two main topics that are from one hand the human health and from the other hand works of art, but the pollutants are the same. And we have, depending on the sources, different kind of pollutants. First of all, we have some guesses. During the previous talks, we have heard we have here some people that have considered the interaction between these pollutants, and in particular SO2 and the surfaces of works of art. Both the sources, outdoor and indoor sources, are present within the museums and the historical building, which are the places where we have to carry out this monitoring. And together with the gases, we have the aerosol particulate matter, so particles that can be of larger dimension, such as PM10 and PM2.5, so particle with diameters less than 10 micrometers and less than 2.5 micrometers. And then we have the ultrafine fraction. This ultrafine fraction is of concern for cultural heritage, as we will see, since these particles are able to penetrate in depth within the surfaces, since often their dimension is the same, such as the surface porosity. And another important aspect to be considered is that the hazard linked to the particles depend not only on the dimension, but also on the concentration in mass and also on the chemical composition. For the gases, as we have mentioned before, we have SO2, volatile organic compounds, NO2, and ozone. All these species can react with the surfaces, inducing degradation and, in general, negative effects. And often, they are, in particular, gases often are emitted by specific indoor sources, but they can also be transported from outdoor. They can react directly with the surfaces or can be transformed into secondary pollutants such as nitric acid or sulfuric acid. While outdoor, we have some limits for atmospheric pollutants that have not to be exceeded. If we consider indoor environments, so museums and historical buildings and churches and so on, so all these environments where work of art are stored, it is important to remember that there are not limits that are reported in the legislation, but there are just suggested limits. So in Italy, we have this guidance document, but more in general, depending on the institution that has carried out researches in this field, we have different limits for these pollutants, so gaseous pollutants and particles. Just suggested, so they and are different depending on the study that has been carried out. Now I will show you briefly three case studies, concerning monitoring of pollutants, of atmospheric pollutants in indoor environments. The first one is the monitoring of particulate matter at Di Pietà Rondanini in Milan at Castello Sforzesco. The second one is also in Milan at the Pinacoteca Ambrosiana, also in this case, particulate matter monitoring. And the third one is a study we have carried out on an ancient tapestry, which is stored at the Palazzo del Quirinale in Rome, where we have analyzed the deposited particulate matter. So, Pietà Rondanini, this very famous statue, was one of the last work of art realized by Michelangelo Buonarroti, was stored until 2005 in this hall inside the Museum of Ancient Arts of Castello Sforzesco in Milan. Then in 2016 it was moved in another hall less affected by pollution, which is in any case inside the Castello Sforzesco. And in fact, what it was measured in 2004-2005, when the statue was placed inside the Museum of Ancient Art, what we found was that indoor concentration of particles, as you can see here, in both the seasons, so in summer and in winter, were higher indoor with respect to outdoor concentration. And this is very very harmful for the marble surface of the statue. Here you can see the instrument placed inside the hall, and as a reference, we have carried out outdoor measurement over this balcony, which is placed here where it is indicated by the arrows. Since we have also analyzed the chemical composition of this particulate matter, what was found was that the concentration of the carbonaceous fraction was particularly high, especially during winter. And this particle can seriously affect the surface of the statue. And here you can see some images acquired by scanning electron microscopy, where together with the particle of biological nature, we have here the small one particle are the carbonaceous particles, and also we have found some metals. This is important. This is an important fact, since we know that this metal can act as a catalyst in the degradation processes. So the second study has been carried out at the Ambrosiana Art Gallery, and in particular in the hall where this cardboard is stored. Is one of the most important work of art stored in Milan. It is the preparatory cardboard of the School of Athens by Raffaello Sanzio. The painting is stored in Rome. We know that Ambrosiana Gallery is one of the most important gallery in Milan, where very precious works of art are stored, such as this portrait, very famous portrait of a musician by Leonardo da Vinci, the Atlantic Code by Leonardo, and also this very famous painting by Caravaggio. So the monitoring of air quality inside this museum is particularly important for the conservation and the preservation of all this work of art. And first of all, but our aim was the monitoring of the pollutants specifically in the hole where this cardboard was stored. During the monitoring campaign that was carried out in 2017 in autumn and during spring in 2018, the cardboard was submitted to restoration, as you can see from this image. Since it was necessary to realize that after the restoration of the work of art, a new showcase, here you can see the old one, and since it was necessary to realize a new showcase, it was important to know in more in depth the air quality within the room in order to put, for example, within the showcase some filters to be able to remove, for example, gases or particles if the concentration of these pollutants in the hole was too high. This is the painting which is stored in Rome. So we used different kind of instrumentation. I will not describe in details them, not to bore you, but in any case, this instrument allowed to analyze, to monitor particle concentration, and in particular, to measure the concentration of black carbon. Black carbon is that fraction which is characterized by a black color, and this fraction can interact with the surface and penetrate into the porosity, causing phenomena such as the soiling of the end. Since in this case the work was a cardboard, so paper, it was particularly dangerous for the surface, the interaction with this kind of particles. Then we collected also the particle on filters and realized the chemical speciation. Here is an image, a picture of the instrument placed within the hole where the cardboard is stored. And here the instrument have been placed in another hole nearby the hole of the cardboard to have a reference. It is important to underline that while during the measurement the hole of the cardboard was not accessible to the visitors, this room four was normally accessible to visitors during the restoration of the cardboard. So we thought that in this case it was possible to observe some effect due to the transportation of pollutant because of the presence of these visitors. But we didn't observe this phenomenon. Why? Since here you can see the number of visitors, this dotted line, and Monday was the day of during which the museum was closed. But you can observe that there is not a correlation between the concentration of the particle and the number of the visitors. In fact, in this case, we have hypothesized that particle concentrations were mainly due to penetration of particles from outdoors. So the effect of a visitor was in this case not so important. And this is quite for this kind of museum, such as the Pinacoteca Ambrosiana, it is quite expected this phenomenon, since it is an old, a very old building with a not so efficient system of ventilation and air exchange and filtration of the outdoor air. Sometimes it was here we have the comparison with outdoor concentration, and sometimes it has been observed that indoor concentration were higher than outdoor. And also this effect is quite is to be taken into consideration for the in order to improve, and this is a demonstration of the fact that the there is a need of improving air air quality to protect and the works of art stored in this museum. If we compare the concentration found with the limits suggested by the legislations that is taken as reference in Italy, we observe that in some cases, in particular during autumn, these concentrations are exceeded. Another important fact is that if we consider the ratio between PM2.5 and PM10, this ratio, in particular during night, is almost equal to one. And this means that this fraction is formed by PM2.5 is really made during night by small, very, very small particle. And the concentration of PM10 is really lower, particularly during the night, but it is also expected since we have the deposition of larger particle. And to conclude this, the results, the main results obtained in this monitor during this monitoring campaign, here you can see the trend for black carbon measure in the blue color, measure with an instrument dedicated to collect this kind of data, together with the measurement carried out by a nanoscan, which is an instrument able to measure the particle dimension. So there is a very good correlation between the two trends, these two trends. And this means that black carbon inside this hole is mainly present within a diffraction with a diameter lower than 200 nanometers, since this is diffraction measured by this nanoscan instrument in red. And this is represent a serious threat for the board card, since this particle can really penetrate. Here we have another image acquired by scanning electron microscopy. Also in this case, we have the presence of metals. The complete, what we can made is also the complete chemical characterization of the particulate matter collected on the filters to highlight the difference between, for example, in this case, these two rooms, but we can also acquire information on the difference of the chemical composition of particulate matter indoor and outdoor to have information on the sources. And all of this data obviously are very important in order to adopt a mitigation policy to reduce the contribution of these sources that contribute to the PM mass balance. Last case is, as I have mentioned you before, the analysis of the deposit particulate matter present on this tapestry. This ancient tapestry is a lower border fragment by the Ulysses stories. It is stored at the Quirinale Palace in Rome. In this case, the issue was to assess which was the better cleaning procedure to adopt, in particular to clean the metallic yarns used to realize the central medallion present on the tapestry, which represent the initial of the commitment of the tapestry, which was Carlo Emanuele second of Savoy and his wife. These were the two important commitments of this tapestry. Here you can see how the yarn are covered with gold in this case gold and also silver, since these two metals were employed to realize the central part of this tapestry. The study of the deposited particulate matter was only one part of a multi-analytical study that we have recently carried out on this tapestry, and which consisted also in the chemical analysis of the dyes used for the decorations, for the natural dyes such as anthraquinones and other organic molecules used to dye the yarns. But in this case, the focus was the analysis of the dirt deposited on the tapestry. So we carried out a measurement of the dirt collected during some cleaning tests carried out by... Sorry?
Paola, 2 minutes, is okay?
Okay, I have finished. Carried out, this test have been carried out using different cleaning procedure. One method was an innovative method based on an hydroaspiration system. And this method was compared with the traditional method. The filters were placed, I will show you an example here, a traditional, here you can see washing of the tapestry, so a traditional method, but the filters, for example, in this innovative cleaning method based on hydroaspiration, the filter were placed here in this position within the machine. Some water was put on the surface, and the aspiration system allowed to collect the dirt, and here we have the filter. So we have analyzed this filter. It is interesting to underline that these yarns show the presence of a patina, a protective patina, formed mainly by sulfur, by silver sulfide. This silver sulfide formed because of the interaction with the gases such as sulfhydric acid. And this process brought to the formation of the self-protection patina. So the very important thing was to have an efficient system to clean the surface, but also to avoid to remove this patina. For this reason, some mock-up samples were realized, put in some artificial artificial particulate matter on small pieces of tapestry. These filters were collected and analyzed, and what it was observed was that this system, hydroaspiration system, was more efficient in removing dirt with respect to the traditional system. Obviously, washing by immersion was the most efficient system, but it is also quite invasive as a procedure, so as to be avoided, and this new method has to be preferred. Also here, I have concluded, we see that method C and D during aspiration have collected some larger particles containing silvers and also gold. So this system is more invasive with respect to this new method, where you can see that the concentration is of this particle is very low. I have concluded. Now we are monitoring air quality within this church, which is the Santuario della Beata Vergine in Saronno, where we are making a measurement of the aerosol particulate matter by these instruments that are placed in among these are wooden statue, very important wooden statue by Renaissance period. So thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Paola, for the very clear and interesting talk. Are there questions for Paola?
I have a curiosity.
There is a curiosity and a question. Yes. First, a curiosity.
Do you think that the large use of disinfectants in this pandemic period can affect...
Sorry, I have not heard. I cannot hear you very, very well. If you can repeat.
Do you think that the use of disinfectants in this pandemic period, large use of these products, can affect the air quality in indoor places, like churches? I don't know.
Yes, I think, in fact, this is a very important issue. I think that they can affect, since the use of these substances in any case contribute to increase both gaseous concentrations, since you have something that can be vaporized, so VOC, and this can affect the surfaces and also the particles. And also we have to take into account that when VOC are emitted, they can also transform into secondary pollutants. So if you use the same, for example, disinfectant in different environments, you can have different effects, since the pollution present in that specific environment are different. So you cannot predict which kind of reaction can occur between this pollutant and also with the surfaces. In particular, in the last case, for example, in the Santuario of Saronno, this statue are wooden statue, and wooden is a very critical material from this point of view, since it can easily absorb substances. So this is a problem that has to be faced, a new problem.
Okay, many thanks.
Thank you. Matteo?
Good evening, Paola. So I was very intrigued by the data that you have shown about the Pietà Rondanini and Pinacoteca Ambrosiana. And I wonder, I mean, you also tried, on top of giving us the data, you also tried to give some explanations about why the indoor air quality is different from outdoor, why the visitors affect the air quality.
Yeah.
My question is, in general, yourself and the restorers, are they satisfied by the explanations, or maybe some mathematical modeling could try to give more in-depth explanations and maybe try to design a way to avoid the risk for the works of art?
No, no, I think that mathematical models are welcome. And this is, in fact, I think that it is fundamental, this aspect, since from our point of view, we can arrive at the chemical characterization. So these are the sources, but to predict by means of models how these pollutants can diffuse and how we can avoid to have this concentration and this penetration is very important. So, for example, also it is important, in my opinion, to have models that can help us to foresee which kind of measurements have to be adopted. So which kind of ventilation, since perhaps the museums, the application of the employment of a new filtration system is very expensive, and so it would be of great help to have the possibility to predict which is the better system to be applied, the better air filtration system, the better system to reduce this penetration. So there is
Thank you very much.
Much work to do together, chemists and mathematicians.
Thank you very much, Paola.
Thank you.
Until we work on the problem, please switch off the ventilation in the museums. It doesn't help. So, see you. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye.
So,
we will start again at 7:30 with the round table.
5:30.
5:30 for this.